I value prayers, if you would. Don't go worrying about me, I'm okay. I went to the doctors simply because I've been getting breathless quite easily. And anyway, I saw the doctor and he did his various tests. He did a blood test. And then on Friday, he sent me for an ECG. And before I went to the ECG, I said to my, I think I need to go and shave my chest. I'm a very hairy person. I mean, extremely hairy. And Mark said, no, you make a mess of the bathroom. I said, well, I'll do the bathroom. I am, it's obvious. It's true. It's like a bush. Anyway, I didn't shave. So I got there and took my T-shirt off. But the next oh, my goodness. She said, you're like an ape. So anyway, I lay down on the bed and she obviously, I'm like a patchwork quilt over here. So she started to shave then. She said, I'll have to get another razor. So she got another razor and started cutting. Anyway, I said to her, I know you can't really say it. I said, but you know, if it's normal, you can tell me, can you? She said, yes, I can. If there's nothing, so if there's something, you know, abnormal, we'll send you upstairs for a scan right away. But anyway, I said to her, I can tell you now it's normal. Tell you that before you do it's normal. I know I've got a good ticket, a good engine. So anyway, she said, she did it, she went, you're right, you're normal. Yeah, totally normal. I've got to get that right. Anyway, I'm a 10-year-old, I'm a 10-year-old. Oh yes, I've got to go for some more blood tests this coming Wednesday. So, you know, if you could just remember me in prayer, I would value that, you know, that God will be doing a good work in my body. Amen? Amen. There we go. Right, let's get back to the Word of God. I want to get across to you that God is not way, way out there as some, you know, detached landlord. He is a personal God. He is a God who wants to be involved in your life and as close to you as the person who is next to you is. He's so close to you. He's a personal God. And one of the things that you find in the book of Psalms is that you find people, in particular King David, going through stuff in his life. And by the way, bad things do happen to good people. You know, and David is actually written up in this way, a man after my own heart. And yet David does some very wicked things. But on David's sacred journey, there are times when he cries out to God in anguish in the Psalms. You read the pain in his life when he's crying out to God. Sometimes he cries out, Lord, where are you? Lord, how come the wicked are blessed and I'm doing it your way and I don't seem to prosper? Lord, if you're hearing my cry, get me out of this mess that I'm in. Lord, everything's against me. You know, there was a time with David when he went to a cave called Adullam. He'd already been anointed by Samuel to be king. Okay? But it was on the journey, in the process of becoming king, there was a time he ended up in a cave called the Cave of Adullam. And it says that 300 men came to him. And they were in distress, discouraged, and in debt. Now, that's not a good place to be. Distressed, discouraged, and in debt. But he raised out of those 300 men a mighty army. And I want to tell you, no matter what mess you're in today, that God has actually got his hand upon your life. He's forming you and shaping you and designing you in the way that he wants you to. And he's got great plans for your life. You've got to believe this. I mean, he's got plans for no matter what age you are. You know, again, if I'm just talking about arriving at the ripe old age of 67, which really isn't that old, but I guess to some people it's old, and most of the dreams that I once had, I've had and fulfilled. So I'm now dreaming new dreams. And I'm glad to be dreaming new dreams. And so it may be time for you to dream a new dream. Say amen.
Amen.
I mean, that something has to go. It's not up here. Something has to go from way down, deep down there. I'm not talking about in your heart. I'm talking about something from your gut that cries out, I will dream again.
Amen.
I will dream again. What's that song with that bearded lady called?
This is me.
Have you seen that? I played it. The bearded lady in The Greatest Showman, or whatever it's called, you know, and she says, this is me. And the words are, people have laughed at me, people have looked at me, people have pointed the finger at me, and I've had to hide myself. And then she comes out and she says, this is me.
Yes.
I'm unique. I've been made in the image. I shouldn't say this, by the way, I'm putting these words in. But I'm made in the image and the likeness of Almighty God. And there is no one on planet Earth that is like me, because God chose me to be like me. And I've been formed in my mother's womb. And he was weaving the threads together that would produce the John Harold Marsden that he wanted. And by the way, I've not finished the article. Not yet. He's still working upon me. There's going to be a day, please believe you me, when I meet him face to face, when I will glow in the dark. I'm doing it, I'm not doing it so bad now. I'm not saying in a very noxious way. There's something I believe. I believe if I walk in a dark room, it lights up.
Amen.
I do.
Amen.
I believe if everyone's discouraged in that room, if I'm in that room, then they'll all start to laugh. They'll all get picked up. You've got to believe something about yourself. There's too many people who point the finger at you and try and steal your dream and say, no you can't, look at you, who do you think you are? Well, I'll tell you exactly who I am. My name is John. I'm the man who was sent from God. I know exactly who I am. Nothing to do with my notes, that. Just have an anointing to come up on me and tell you that. Brother John, I was visiting him a couple of weeks ago, and he showed me something using the Psalms and the scriptures on how to pray. Pray using the scriptures. I'd never heard of that. And then on Tuesday night, Penny was sharing with us how we can apply our names. And I'm going to do this in an illustration in a moment. But I want to show you something that you can start to pray. See, my prayers are quite simple, you know. I get down every morning, Lord, here I am. Lord, I pray that you'll bless my family, my marriage, my children, my grandchildren. Protect them, keep them safe, Lord. Keep them from harm, keep them from evil. Lord, bring them into a knowledge of you. Father, I pray for the church, Christ the Rock. I pray for the individual members. I mean, I pray them. And I say the same prayer the next day, and the next day, and the next day. But John showed me that you can pray for scriptures. And so I started to do a little bit of a study, and then I found in the book of Acts chapter 4, 24 through 26, that the Christians who had been praying, what had happened in Acts chapter 3, John and Peter would be going to the temple, and they're going past the gate beautiful, and a lame man was laid there, who had been lame from birth. And remember, he cried out, give me some money, and they said, money we haven't got. But what we do have, we give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk. And the man got up and he walked. We have got something to give. You might not have the money, but you've got something that is far more valuable than money. And it's called, he is called Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so what happens is this, they get told by the religious leaders that they're not to preach in this name, because they've been preaching in the name of Jesus and that he had been risen from the dead. And so when they start to pray as a church, and these are the words that they say. So when they heard that, they raised their voices to God with one accord and said, Lord, you are God who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of your servant David had said, why do the nation rage and the people plot vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. They were quoting from the Psalms. In their prayers, they were quoting from the Psalms. And even Jesus, when he was on the cross, actually prayed quoting from the Psalms. In Matthew 27, verse 46, Jesus is hanging on the cross, and he says, and it is now about the ninth hour. Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was quoting from Psalm 22, and if you read Psalm 22, you'll find that most of that which was prophesied in Psalm 22 was fulfilled on the cross when Jesus died. He was praying the scriptures. Charles Spurgeon, a very well-known preacher, said this: if Christ lived upon the word of God, should not you and I do the same? Almost all of the scriptures can be used for prayer. Almost all of them, but the best place to start is in the Psalms. I'm going to help you with it this morning. Give you a little bit. Now, make a mental note of this, or write it down. If you can, if you don't got something to write it down, think of a little coat hanger in your head. Okay, here's the first thing I want you to do. It starts with R. Look for something to rejoice about. I don't feel like rejoicing. Then look for something.
Yeah.
The second thing is look for something to repent about. Oh, you see, that's a very abrasive word, John. You have to understand what the word repent means. Repent means to think differently afterwards. Something's been going on in my life and it's not going right. I need to think differently. And then the third thing is to request. Find something that you can ask for. Maybe for yourself or for other people. So we can say that what in this passage gives you a reason to rejoice? What in this passage reveals sin in my own life that should lead me to change the way I think? Change the way you think, you change your life. Does this passage make me make a request of God for myself or for another? All prayers of the Bible are such that when we pray together, we pray with Jesus Christ. Now, this was part something I found in my study. When we pray, we actually pray with Jesus. Can you believe that? I mean, there's thousands of prayers going on all the time, but we pray with Jesus. Hebrews 7:25 says this: let us draw near to God through him, Jesus, since he always lives to make intercession for us. In other words, right now, Jesus is praying for you. If Jesus is praying for you, could you not believe that God the Father would listen to his Son? Definitely, most definitely. And so we need to dovetail our prayers in with Jesus. But again, let me just help you. Let me just show you praying two Psalms, how to pray the Psalms. This is one that I've actually prayed. Psalm 40. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me, and he heard my cry. Let me just put a pause there. Notice this, it says, I waited patiently for the Lord. So, I don't know if you're like me, but when I say a prayer, I want to answer right here and now. Do it now, God, I don't want to wait. Make a pot noodle prayer. I'll just, you know, put it, just, you know, 2 minutes and it's done. You know, I can have something to eat. You know, please, Lord, do it and do it right now. But the Bible says, I waited patiently for the Lord. I could tell you still now I have to wait patiently, but the one thing I can tell you, he inclined his ear to me, and he heard my cry. I quoted to you earlier on from Isaiah chapter 40. That was a word given to me when in the middle of the most trying time of my life. You would not believe it. I was so down there. I was so much in distress, so discouraged, so out of my mind with worry. I didn't know which way to turn. Do I go this way? Do I go that way? Do I go forward? Do I go back? I don't know what to do. But I waited patiently. Verse 2 says this, he brought me up out of a horrible pit. It was a horrible pit. And by the way, part of it was my own doing. I was stupid. I needed to repent. I got myself into a right mess. Have you ever heard of the Niagara syndrome? No? Anybody? The Niagara syndrome is, well, what you do, you fall into the river. And you just go with the flow. And you just go with anything. And you don't make any good decisions or quality decisions about where you're going or what should happen in life. You just go with the flow. Until one day, you start to hear a noise. And you realize that you're getting closer and closer to one almighty waterfall. And you start to paddle to go in the opposite direction. How do I get out of this? It's because you just go with the flow. You just allow things to happen. But now is the time to stop allowing things to happen. It's time now to make some quality decisions about your life. I'm going to do it. And I'm going to do it God's way. And he brought me out of a horrible pit. Out of the miry clay. It was deep yogurt. Stinking yogurt that I was in. But he heard my cry and he brought me up out of the horrible pit, out of the miry clay. And then he set my feet upon a rock and he established my steps. And he's put a new song in my mouth. Praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. That's my testimony. That's part of my journey. If you want, I know you might say, well, John, you don't know how I feel right now. You know what? You're right. I don't know how you feel right now. But I do know what it is to feel like that. Because I've been in the horrible pit.
That's right.
I've been down there. I know what it's like not to know which way to turn. Then Penny, she really encouraged me. She said, watch this. This is fantastic. I think it's absolutely brilliant. She said to me, she was taught, wherever it said me, my eye, to put her name. So I want you to put your name. I'm going to use my name. You'll know this now really well. The Lord is John Shepherd. John shall not want. He makes John to lie down in green pastures. He leads John beside the still waters. He restores John's soul. He leads John in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though John walks through the valley of the shadow of death, John will fear no evil. For you are with John. Your rod and your staff, they comfort John. You prepare a table before John in the presence of John's enemies. You anoint John's head with oil. John's cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow John all the days of John's life. And John will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Forever. Call your name in it. Call your name in it. It was meant for you. It was meant for you. And so I want to say thank you to my brother John and thank you to my sister Penny.
Yes.
The pastor doesn't always have it, but the law of synergy together, we've got it. We've got something powerful, and we need to start to dream the great dream, the God dream, that God's going to do a fantastic work in us and through us. And even if you are in a horrible pit today, know this, that he can hear the faintest cry. All you've got to do is blink one eyelid in his direction, and he comes to your rescue. He came to mind. At a time when I wasn't even thinking about him, I turned my back on him. I made him lots of promises. Dare I turn around and look at him again? Yeah, I just got to, because you see, I'm in such a mess. I need you. But he inclined his ear to my prayer. And he came to my horrible pit. And he lifted me out of the miry clay. And he put my feet upon a solid rock.
Yes.
And they said, I can't just leave him like that. I need to give him a new song. Yes. So he can sing the song of the Redeemer.
Yes.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Yes. Amen. Yes. Prove your life. I look to laugh and cry.
Yes.
Amen. I think we need to sing a celebration song.